At a certain point, the protagonist in the book is introduced to a sort of magical machine by the gypsies. The gypsies have the original tarot in this book. And the original tarot is not a set of cards there, but little sculptures, little figurines. And there is a big round plate, and on this plate, arranged sort of like a mandala, are all the little figures that are the tarot cards. And in the center, sort of in the hub of this turning table, is the fool. And so they're golden figurines, and he stands there, you know, as he sort of snuck into the gypsy's place to see this and all of that, and because the gypsies are by no means happy about it. But he looks at it and sees this turn, and see it turn, this amazing dance, and as he keeps looking at it, he sees that the fool is not just in the middle, but wherever he looks, the fool is there. And so every figure on the table is the fool, and then he isn't, and then he is, and then he isn't. He is here, he is there, and he's all of them at the same time. Now, that's the kind of thing that we are talking about. This is, well, maybe that's one of the reasons why in a lot of the early scriptures, certainly Gnostic scriptures, Pistis Sophia and others, Jesus, the living one, the living one spoke, the living Jesus. These are, the Gospel of Thomas starts with, these are the words which the living Jesus spoke, and Didymus, Judas, Thomas wrote. Now, there are technical reasons perhaps for that, but this is the figure that is alive, that can be everywhere at the same time, that still has that mysterious quality of what Alan Watts, God bless him, wherever he is journeying in a mentor, was wont to say, the weird. You know, not just weird, but the weird. The Alan, one of his saying was, everyone is entitled to his own kind of weird. And he certainly had his own kind. But this is the sort of thing that you find in some of the Nag Hammadi scriptures. I think the Apocryphon of John, and you heard this, many of you have, where the story is told as to how Jesus chooses John and his brothers, the sons of Zebedee, as his disciples. And they are fishermen, and they are out fishing on the lake, probably Lake of Galilee or whatever, and three guys sitting in the boat, and the three brothers. And one of them looks to the shore and he says, there is a man standing there who is beckoning to us. The other one looks and says, I don't see a man, I see a child. The third one says, I don't see anybody. Now, you see, people repeat a lot of things that they hear and that sound good to them, and maybe they have even an intuitive apprehension as to what they repeat them, but all my life I heard people repeat the phrase that how dogmas are bad. If you ask them why dogmas are bad, they can't really tell you. Maybe they would say, well, because they're telling me I should believe something, and nobody is going to tell me what to believe. Well, I sympathize with people who say that nobody is going to tell me anything, because ever since I was a small child, I had a great desire for a condition where nobody is going to tell me what to do. And I did try to pursue that path as much as I could. It got me into a lot of trouble, too. But so you say, I want to be free to believe anything I want to. Yeah, well, do you want to believe that you're, do you want to believe that you have worms in your head? You're not really free to believe anything. Because if you believe totally absurd things, you're going to be a nut. You're going to be crazy. So that's not the issue either. So what is the issue? People can't tell you. Let me suggest to you what is really wrong with dogma. What is really wrong with dogma is because it tries to force everyone to see the same thing standing on the shore there, even though you don't see it. You see? And in so doing, it does what? It's not that it takes away your freedom. You know what? I'm a big believer in freedom. You know that. I even wrote about it and everything else. But you know what? When it comes to these deeper things, you are not really all that free. You are not free to turn your face from the truth. If you do that, you're a fool. You're not free. You know? You are not free, really. You shouldn't really be free. You shouldn't accord yourself to freedom to fritter your precious life, your precious energy away on nonsense. Whether that nonsense is going after money, or going after power, or going after sex, or going after flying saucers, or going after politics, you are not really free to do that. Because if you do it, you're a fool, and you are wasting a precious opportunity. That's not freedom. But what you have to be free to do is connect yourself with this incredible source of creativity, where all these possibilities exist, and where the plenum, the pleroma, the fullness of possibilities can sort of come forth into conscious manifestation through you. That is important. And that is why dogma is counterproductive. Because it takes that possibility, that option away, and reduces everything to a common belief. You see? You all have to believe this just the way it is. And then you don't see what you are supposed to see calling to you from the seashore anymore. So, see, there is no accuracy in these matters. There is a right direction, however. That's why I said, if you turn your face away from the right direction and you devote your energy to trivialities instead, you are doing something very silly, and you are doing something that at some point or the other you are going to regret. But when you are moving in the right direction, then you are moving into a boundless realm of creative possibilities, which all have an enlivening and therefore a transformative effect on you. And you begin to see the Lord of the dance here and there and everywhere. The center of the circle is there. But it takes a certain inner eye to see it. And this inner eye is not the vision of faith as conventionally understood. Because such faith is just belief in someone else's belief. And it doesn't really make all that much difference whether your belief is, I don't know, St. Augustine's belief or Luther's belief or something like that, or of some crazy fool in Sedona who will tell you what he heard from the flying saucers the previous day and talk to you about the vortices, you know. People actually, I have friends in Sedona who observe these things with detached bemusement. You know, people go and sit on certain mountains because they want to sit on the vortex. But it's just a belief, you see. They don't know. They haven't experienced anything. But there's some, I don't know, a former hairdresser with a weird hairdo, I don't know, Gabriel of Sedona or whatever his name is, you know, as distinguished from the Archangel Gabriel of Palestine, you know, who'll tell you, well, the soul saucers were here and this and that and the other thing and so forth. But it's just a belief. So it's a belief in someone else's belief. Neither is it factual knowledge, because the facts are few and subject to dispute. But rather it is a knowing beyond faith and factual knowledge. It is this kind of knowing, this understanding by way of gnosis, that is enjoined upon us in the Gospel according to Thomas. In the 86th Logion, we have Jesus saying, somewhat similar to in Matthew and in Luke, the foxes have their holes, and the birds have their nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head to rest. Assuredly not. So here again, you see, this is not necessarily a complaint. Everybody has a place in this world, says the teacher. I don't have one. Of course. Because he does not fit anywhere. He doesn't have a place to lay his head because he falls between the cracks. And let me assure you, He falls between the cracks of orthodoxy as much as he falls between the cracks of the New Age and all of that. You see? You can't capture somebody like that with terms. Oh, karma. Oh, reincarnation. None of these have any relevance. It doesn't fit these models any more than any other. Okay? The Logos is from beyond this world. Doesn't fit anywhere in this world.